Good morning to all. I'm very honored to be here today to share with you some thoughts as a nutritionist in the area of low-calorie and non-nutritive sweeteners. I would like to thank Mr. Panditika and Ms. Rekha. I've not been back to India for some years. I'm with also ILSI, Southeast Asia region, so the two regions work quite closely in various areas of food safety and nutrition. And just before I begin, just to share with you some reflections after hearing Dr. Marwaha's talk, excellent coverage, very comprehensive coverage on nutrition problems. Just to share with you that the issues you talk about not so different from what we experience in Malaysia. Rapidly developing nutrition transition, health transition, increasing affluence of the country. We are supposed to be a developed country in 5 years' time, so everybody is rushing to gain wealth. In the rush for that, people forget about healthy eating. People forget about active living. People just rush to gain wealth, economic wealth, material wealth. And because of that, we pay heavily for that kind of mistakes. And the mistakes are overweight and obesity in my country in adults is 50%, 50, maybe higher than yours. In young children, primary school children is 30%, higher than yours. And obesity is higher than overweight in young children. We would have thought overweight is higher than obesity. In a study that we're going to publish in a few weeks' time, we will share that data. And diabetes is 18-20% in my country. So this is very disastrous for us. We are also grappling with undernutrition, stunting in some segments of the community. So that is a disaster that we are facing, and overeating, including excessive sugar intake, then is a problem amongst our communities. So sharing with you as a nutritionist, in our perspectives of how do sweeteners fit into a daily diet of a person, not just a diabetic, but ordinary person, can they fit in a daily diet of a person? Yes, it can, and we should also use this judiciously, appropriately, and prudently. Well, we have spoken quite a bit about excessive sugar intake from various food sources and beverages, and we all like sweet taste. We have a good group of Indians in Malaysia. They all love sweet taste. Chinese love sweet taste. Malays love sweet taste. We all have a sweet tooth in some of us, in many of us. So we sometimes forget that we are taking too much sugar from various sources. We call them hidden sugars in foods and beverages. And of course, we have heard so much about it. Excessive sugar intake then contributes to unnecessary calorie intake. And we also heard from Mr. Panditika that we have to run so many minutes, so many hours to get rid of the excess energy. So we'll say tomorrow we'll do take that run or that treadmill. That tomorrow never comes, unfortunately. So keep on gaining weight and we never gone to walk or to do the exercise. So in some communities, sweetened beverages is a problem. But in Malaysia, for example, I do not believe that is so. Many of our local foods are very high in sweets. And the rising trend of obesity because excessive energy intake, not just coming from sugar, but total calorie intake then is a concern, as I've shared with you, in Malaysia and many countries in this part of the world also. Overconsumption of sugar also is blamed for dental caries increase in many countries. So these are some of the lovely pictures that we see of foods and beverages on your left hand side is the local foods that we have in Malaysia. They are very sweet and people love it, simply love it. Yeah, not just only the soft drinks that people take excessive sugar. So realizing this, the WHO guideline has been alluded to, not more than 10% of energy should come from sugar. I often wonder how do people know what is 10% of energy. So countries have translated those into dietary guidelines in the region. And all countries in the region have dietary guidelines. Malaysia has. We don't have a figure like 10% energy coming from sugar. General message is reduce intake of foods and beverages low in sugar. Because we don't know how to tell the people what is 10% of energy, I suppose. Not even nutritionists know how to do that easily. So in order to maintain a sweet taste and the sweet taste that some people like, so people have gone to opt for sugar-free alternatives of foods or diet, so-called diet products. These are foods added with low-calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners. And of course, the more health-conscious people are opting for such foods, and industries have made available such healthy alternatives with less sugar or no sugar, make them available to the consumers. So what I will talk about in this presentation is general discussion on low-calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners and how they can help people who like the sweet taste and yet do not want the calories in their diet. So I will touch a bit very quickly on introduction to terminologies, although we have heard in the two lectures this morning some introduction to these and various types and classification of sugar substitutes. Also, some speakers alluded to this already, and I will summarize their uses in a range of foods and beverages. I will more importantly summarize the overall benefits of using this low-calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners, how they can be helpful in weight management and also in diabetic persons with diabetes, and also addresses consumer concerns. Dr. Rahman has already spoken some of these and set the stage for some discussion on these people's perception about non-safety, non-safe use of such sweeteners. And just share with you two slides lastly on how we should judiciously, prudently use such sweeteners in our daily diet. So introduction to sugar substitutes. And these are, as the name suggests, these are substitutes for regular table sugars or sucrose or honey or brown sugar or white sugar, different names that we give to the sugar that we have. So some of these or many of these have no calories. So these sugar substitutes, that's why we call them low calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners. They do not provide any calories. Many of these substitutes will be available. We will be hearing more of these kinds of substitutes, many of these artificial sweeteners, and different names have been given to these low-calorie or non-caloric sweeteners, very simply because they do not supply any calorie or energy to the diet, to the food added, or non-nutritive sweeteners, or artificial sweeteners, or simply just sweeteners. This has also been used. We really need to understand the terminologies used. I find as I read the literature, some people use it very loosely, and artificial sweetener can be widely used to refer to many, many things. Yeah? And various terms, various groupings have been used to talk about artificial sweeteners or sugar substitutes. So when we talk about artificial sweeteners, these are, as the name suggests, synthetic sugar substitutes. But they can also be derived from natural herbs, from sugar itself, and modified by some chemical processes or physical processes. So these are synthetic sugar substitutes, and many of these artificial sweeteners are also known as intense sweeteners. These are now new terminologies introduced to consumers. Intense meaning they are many times sweeter than just sucrose, the common sugar that we know. For example, aspartame K is, and aspartame are 200 times. These are two sweeteners you've already heard quite a bit this morning. Yeah? They are about 200 times sweeter than sugar. Well, then because of that, then very small amounts required. Yeah? So in order to exceed the ADI, you can imagine that you may need to take many, many times this aspartame. You will not likely to exceed the ADI, acceptable daily intake of these sweeteners. So small amounts are required to give you the sweet taste and yet do not give you any calories. So that is then the basis for using synthetic sweeteners or artificial sweeteners or non-calorie sweeteners. So they contribute very little or almost no calories to the diet. So they maintain the sweetness in the food and as a beverage, but not adding the calories to the diet or the beverage. And we will hear a lot from Dr. Magnusson later on. They have a long history of safe use, many, many times evaluated. They are probably the most studied, most scrutinized and reviewed food additives, food ingredients in the world today, and passed many, many times of rigorous safety assessment. Yeah? And I will not go into detail in this aspect. And to further convince that they are safe, many regulatory agencies have approved their use, not just in one or two countries, but regulatory agencies around the world have approved their use. This means that these agencies have scrutinized their safety and have approved their use for everyone in the country, all age groups. And I will just share with you, we have heard about how India approved the use of some of these sweeteners. Malaysia Ministry of Health approved the use through regulations 118A, 132A, 133, and 134, and one can download details of these permitted sweeteners from this link. And actual examples of these sweeteners is alpha K, for example, aspartame, neotame, saccharin, and stevia. These are the non-nutritive sweeteners permitted in Malaysia, and sugar alcohols also permitted, several of them, glycerol, isomalt, and so on. Now, the Malaysian regulation is now undergoing a drastic revamp. We are now going to adopt the Codex Alimentarius totally. So whatever is inside Codex Alimentarius, we're going to allow automatically. So we do not want to go through another step of evaluation, and we'll just adopt what Codex Alimentarius has. So it's on the way for gazettement by the Ministry of Health, Malaysia. Some chemical structure of this, I also see that ILSI has given you a handout, very good information there, A-Sulfam-K and aspartame, information on its users and approval in India already given in a handout, neotame, saccharin, stevia, sweetener extracted from plant, and the sugar alcohols that I mentioned. They are, of course, not actually alcohols, but they are polyols. So examples of tabletop sweeteners available commercially, these are some examples that you can also see in this hotel in the breakfast coffee table I saw. And the users now of these non-nutritive sweeteners in a wide range of processed foods and drinks, at least in USA and Europe, but not in my country in Malaysia, not that widely used. The most widely used are in jams and also in sweetened beverages. So baked goods, soft drinks, powdered drink mixes, candies, chewing gums, dairy products, yogurts, many foods and beverages you see. It's also used in for home cooking. People who want to have the sweet taste but not the calorie, they can also use these. Some of these are suitable. But for those who cannot stand high heat, then of course you cannot use this. So not all sweeteners are suitable for use for home cooking and high temperature use. Now some examples of foods and beverages containing this low calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners, and some specific examples I would like to share with you. Just want to draw attention here that it may not be very clear from the outside packaging that these foods contain sweeteners. If you look at the front pack of this chewing gum, it does not say that it contains a sweetener. But if you look carefully at the ingredient, the sweetener is mentioned. As required by food regulations, you must mention that. So my point is that we should inform the consumer to look for the ingredient listing. It may not be so apparent, yeah, in the front of pack. This is a yogurt, and again, at the ingredient listing, you can find the listing of the sweetener stated very clearly there. And this is juice, and again sweeten a mixture of aspartame and saccharin. Is used. So the word light is only on the front. The use of these low-calorie or non-nutritive sweeteners, and also at concern about this and why we should not be concerned of using the non-nutritive sweeteners. So using giving the sweet taste minus the calories. So studies, many studies, including human trials, have shown replacement of the sugar with these sweeteners are useful in calorie intake and therefore useful in weight management. Yeah? Again, we must say that some positive studies, some negative studies, but overall evidence seems to suggest that appropriate use of these can help in weight management. So recommending the use of sugar substitutes in beverages versus just a dietary restriction. If you tell a person going on weight, stop drinking this, stop taking this and that, he's not going to comply to the diet. He's going to fail and he will not manage to lose his weight. So it has been found that if you give him the sweet taste and not too much modify his diet, he may be able to comply with his diet restriction better. And in that sense then, he can lose his weight and be able to maintain and keep that weight down. So this is then the rationale for using better dietary compliance. Is very important. You can preach to the patient, you can preach to the person if he doesn't follow the diet that you advocate or advise is not going to work. So individuals feel more satisfied. Yeah? Feel good is very important. Feeling satisfied is very important. So if they're happy with the eating plan, they'll continue and do some exercise, of course, together with it, yeah? Then he's likely to be successful in weight management. Yeah? I find that rationale may be acceptable for using this non-nutritive sweeteners. So substituting the other reason for using non-nutritive sweeteners on NNS is sweeteners may help in blood sugar control. And many studies have also demonstrated that the American Diabetes Association in their dietary management of their glucose level and people with type 2 diabetes have greater flexibility. Again, just like the weight management person, he can have greater flexibility of the types of foods that he can take. That way, then, he's likely to have to manage his glucose better and therefore control his diabetes better. The use of this sweetener is then useful in that sense. If he has a wider choice of foods with his sweet taste that he needs to satisfy, then his dietary plan sweeteners, what are they really? And they are supposed to be synthetic. They are chemicals. So whatever chemicals must be bad to their mind, yeah? Actually, chemical, if you think of it, yeah? So we need to educate consumers in what foods and beverages they can be found if they want to look for these. I must say it's not so easy to find these foods in my country. And how to identify these sweeteners? Looking for ingredient listing. It's not going to be loud and clear in the front panel. How these foods should be eating should also be informed to the consumers. Consumers should be that low-caloric sweeteners or non-nutritive sweeteners are not just for diabetic patients to mind their calories, to manage their calorie intake, then this sweeteners can play a role. Yeah? So they want to enjoy their sweeties, but mind that come with sugar. So consumers are also concerned, are they safe after morning? Are they safe for years of use? Well, it should be I already spoken to you briefly and studied many, many times by various health authorities at national level, regulations only to be passed in the world, I already mentioned, in Malaysia, India, and many countries in the world. Yeah. So just two more concluding slides on this, on my thoughts, and how can we advise consumers the use of these? So these non-nutritive sweeteners may help management, blood sugar control, caries, dental caries, for example, and lots of studies on to demonstrate that. But we must say that they are not magic bullets. They are not going to cure your diabetes. There's no cure for diabetes. They are not going to cure your weight management. Just 1 week taking this is going to, your fat is going to dissolve away. That's not the way how it works. We must explain to the consumer that it replaces sugar, you must still exercise, you must have a balanced diet, variety, and so on. Dietary guidelines must still come in. Yeah? so they are used in moderation with balanced diet and regular exercise program. And if you take a low-calorie sweetener, low sugar, and yet you have lots of fats in your diet, fats also contribute to large amounts of calorie. So we must not forget that part. And also starch. And rice, for example, yeah, we are rice-consuming communities. So all this must be in moderate amounts, in amounts appropriate for that person's daily life, daily activity, and his weight. So if we use that appropriately, then these sugar substitutes will be useful to manage weight, to manage diabetes, to manage sugar control, blood glucose control in a person. That we must tell the consumer. And educating consumer on food labels, food and nutrition label should be carried out. How to find these substitutes? How do they appear on a label? Where to find information on the sweeteners should be informed. Yeah? And this should be made available to the consumer at affordable prices. If you use this sweetener and becomes very expensive, then the people who need it. Actually, if we look at the data now in my country, the people with overweight and obesity are not the affluent. They are not the upper class of the community. They are the middle income group, the lower socioeconomic group. That is also found in many other countries in the world. The lower socioeconomic group have higher problem overweight and obesity, and that is going to be very difficult for us to tackle if we have foods which are beyond their reach. If our information do not reach out to these people, they are the ones who do not access to most of the nutrition information. So that is that's a dilemma that we all have to face with as nutritionists promoting healthy eating. Yeah? Consumer must spend time looking through the ingredient listing, looking for the word diet or light variety, looking for the names of the specific sweeteners. And because, as I mentioned, use sweeteners is not clearly spelled out in the front panel. Yeah? So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Siong. Proud of the use of these non-nutritive sweeteners in Malaysia. Some of the products in which it is being used, the four different non-nutritive sweeteners allowed in there and being used. He brought out also its significance with regard to controlling the blood sugar level, use for diabetic patients, and also the need for awareness to be brought to in terms of the consumers as to its necessity, and also with regard to safety and watching it on the labels. Now the topic is open for discussion. Please, Dr. Marwa.
Yeah, I agree with you that even in US, the obesity is more in the low socioeconomic, because that's where the junk food is eaten more than the upper social. So probably yours is almost like a well-developed nation, and that's the reason. I was wondering whether you come across people who use these regularly, come with some kind of allergic symptoms?
Allergic reactions?
Or in terms of symptoms or signs like gastroenteritis, loose motion, or any rashes or anything, have you come across?
Or any form of reaction to this kind of sweeteners?
Yeah.
No, I have not. It's the taste that some people complain about. Taste of these sweeteners, the different sweeteners have different aftertaste. That will be the main complaint that people have of this use of sweeteners. Some people just don't like the aftertaste. So I do not know of any complaints or allergic reactions or other kinds of reactions to this. Yeah.
Dr. Siong, I represent Zydus Wellness, our brand sugar-free. We are the biggest players in artificial sweeteners. And we are confronted with few challenges, which I say the whole industry is confronted with. One is sweetener in India, majorly comprehended as sugar, not only plays the role of sweet taste, but also as a bulking agent. So now when we talk of replacing sugar with an artificial sweetener, the challenge is not only to replace the sweet taste, but also to replace the bulking properties. Now those bulking properties, I would like to support what Dr. Marwaha said, is often met by polyols. Polyols have their own laxative effect and the limit also is defined. So I would like you to throw some light on that, that what kind of safer bulking agents which do not really affect the gastrointestinal functions can be chosen. My second question is that you have touched the point that because it has such important role to play in addressing obesity and diabetes, so it should be available at affordable price. Is the government anywhere internationally looking into the pricing policy of these artificial sweeteners, and are they planning any long-term action in this direction? That's my question.
Thank you. Thank you for your question. On the, I understand the need for bulking, yeah? You need to have bulk. Sugar plays many roles in the food. I understand that, but I am afraid I'm not able to say what are the different bulking agents, not in my area of expertise, yeah? So I understand the dilemma. You need to find bulking agents that are appropriate. And some people use different, the artificial sweeteners with the polyols together in combination, yeah? Some people do not remove the sweet sugars totally. Those are different ways of doing it, yeah? So that you reduce it, not totally no sugar, but low sugar. So these are different ways that one can approach the problem, yeah? On your question of lowering the price, that's a good question. I wish the government would listen to me. But who am I to? So this is a challenge that we all have to work on and make sure that they are affordable. Yeah, I suppose if the demand is there, the pricing may go down. Yeah, now because the supply is very low, the awareness of use of sweeteners is not there. Consumers are still somehow have this negative perception that sweeteners are bad. You know, I cannot take it for a long time. They're only for diabetic. I face that kind of question many times. So as long as demand is low, price will be high. So it's a story of supply and demand, you know. So if we have wider use of this, then pricing may also go down.
Yeah, please.
It is not a question, but it is a suggestion as well that to what just you have asked. I think so. The xylitol and erythritol are better products which you can use in your products, which you are asking. Yeah, they are polyols. I'm talking about polyols. Yeah, that can be used rather than that. Second part is that generally it is a concept that you have to use these artificial sweeteners or these sweeteners if you are a diabetic patient or you are obese. I think so. A general awareness program is also equally important, that even in the normal way of life, some consumption can be adjusted with sugar and these. That balance may also lead to a good health for persons. Because generally 99% says, now I'm diabetic, I cannot take sugar, so I will go to sweeteners. Real sugar, that is glucose or sucrose, and these sweeteners. Secondly is that natural sugars, generally that misconcepts which are there among people, right, not in only my country, that okay, don't take sugar, but you can take jaggery, you can take honey, but these are the things which will not be effective. Unless otherwise, these things are also not canvassed for. Things may not come up that okay, by this you will do something better. A equally important program should be given, I think so. I will request ILSI that they should be included within these presentations and a public is made aware of these things. That will be more result oriented. Thank you very much.
At the back. Yes.
Level of safety as compared to the other non-calorie sweeteners?
Stevia. The use of stevia, I think, Dr. Magnuson, you will compare the different sweeteners, safety, and so on. Yeah, later on, Dr. Magnuson will also go into detail the comparison to the safety of the different, maybe you're talking about ADI of the different sweeteners, yeah? So, yeah, that will be dealt with in detail, yeah.
Generally, why the combination of ASK and the aspartame is used?
I think, maybe you're from industry, yeah.
ASK is generally added to round off the overall sweetness. Aspartame leaves a very slight metallic taste. I mean, so to round it off, ASK combination is always used. So the ratio generally used is 1:2, and this is generally used in beverages, the cold beverages. I hope I have answered your question. I mean, we can talk in the break if you have more questions.
So the taste of the food, the beverage is very important for the fantastic food that people don't like, that we are failed in our efforts.
Dr. Siong, I think it was mentioned, you responded to the price lowering by saying that, the demand is less, and therefore, the price is high at present of the sweeteners. Now, if there is a misconception among people that there is some problem with the sweeteners and these are not safe, and if, the evidence at present, is not very substantial or not very clear-cut, don't you think we need some more research evidence, especially, long-term use, so that we can dispel these false beliefs if these are so? Or if not, then we have better, understanding of long-term use. Because that is the concern of most people. Once or twice, nobody minds using because nothing is going to happen. But what about long-term use?
Actually, that will also be dealt with by Dr. Magnusson. But to cut it short, long-term history of safe use has been proven for many, many of these sweeteners and scrutinized by many expert groups, including JECFA of FAO, WHO, and many, many regulatory agencies. But there is still, I understand consumers that this is not safe, even amongst healthcare professionals that this is not safe. That is one reason, I suppose, ILSI India is doing this seminar, that we can share and talk about this, and scientific evidence will be presented by Dr. Magnusson later on. It is long-term use. It's safe for long-term use for different age groups of population. So we can discuss further on this, but your role then as a healthcare professional, then we can scrutinize the literature and inform consumers that this is not so, that it's due to perception. And many, many of these messages going around are not based on science. These messages going around are based on various advocates and activist groups that are not based on science. That's my personal opinion. I'm not a consultant for any company, but I do not feel that many of...
I'd like to add to what...
Please identify yourself.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Sumit Arora from National Dairy Research Institute, Karnal. To add to that usage of polyols, the problem is, for example, I received this query from Rocket. A Rocket wants to its, say it wanted to exist for its usage, whether it's going to be stable or its interaction with some of the compounds. Probably we have to define and study their interactions with indigenous dairy products. So my question to you, sir, is in Malaysia, these are all defined products, but are there certain indigenous dairy products in which these artificial sweeteners are also allowed for its use?
They are permitted. The sweeteners that I mentioned, they are permitted for use in a variety of products. And for certain products, there are different groups of foodstuffs permitted. I do not have all those information at hand. I share with you the regulations and some of these sweeteners. So, polyols, for example, there is a warning statement that must be there because excessive use can cause stomach problem, diarrhea problems, for example. So warning statements are there, details are there, and they are permitted for use for a wide variety of foods, many of these polyols. So they have already been approved for use, yeah.
So his specific query is with regard to the dairy products.
There are a lot for dairy products as well, for yogurt, for dairy products, yes.
Any dairy product which undergoes high temperature treatments?
Yes, they are, yes. Some of the sweeteners can take high temperatures, but not all the sweeteners, yeah. So we have to pick and choose, and that's why some people mix sweeteners. So they are permitted for dairy use. I showed two examples of dairy yogurt products. They are not Malaysian product, but
yogurt is not, doesn't undergo very.
You give UST treatment to flavonoids. There is a problem of loss in potency of the sweeteners, as well as, say, in the isulfame K, its degradation product. Say it's one of that was estrostamide. It has even carcinogenic potential, but it does these reaction does not occur in the case of milk. Probably in bakery or in some very high heat processing treatment, it might occur. My issue is, when you study for indigenous dairy products, there has to be a suitable data in place before you are giving its approval.
Yes, agreed. You are going to very detail of technological use, of which I'm not an expert in, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, but certainly I agree with you. You need to study what is suitable for use for what matrix of food, and whether it remains or not.